I'm Judy Umaki, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, vote411.org, before you mark your ballot. Today we have Courtney Neron, incumbent for State Representative District 26. Welcome, Courtney.
Thank you, Judy. It's so nice to be here with you.
Tell us about your background and why you are running for re-election to the House.
Yeah, thanks. So I am a teacher. I've taught high school French and Spanish and a mother of two wonderful children. And in 2018, I decided to try out a run for office to go fight for education funding for the state of Oregon and for all of the kids across the state and in my own classrooms that have been in need of nutrition, wraparound services, counseling, smaller class sizes, quality curriculum, and really wanting to make sure that we are providing stable education and quality education for all of the children of Oregon. So was thrilled that we were able to pass the Student Success Act in my first term. And I'm really ready to continue putting my knowledge and relationships that I've built over the first term to use in a second term. And I'm really hoping that that I can continue to fight for our values, our shared values in the district, because I feel like the work isn't done yet. We still have, we need to talk about higher education, access to community colleges, apprenticeships, and universities at an affordable level. And, but we have made huge strides, and I'm hoping to return to fight for working families and making our communities safer and stronger and healthier. And I'm hoping that my communities will send me back to keep fighting for, again, our shared values.
Budgetary choices, the difficult choices that are going to be necessary because of the economy, the wildfire.
Yes. And this is really going to be very difficult for all of us in the legislature. We're going to have to make some really painful decisions. But for me, I'm always prioritizing the most vulnerable among us and wanting to make sure that we don't leave anybody behind as we rebuild, that we take everyone into consideration and make sure that all voices are represented when we're making our decisions, and really just needing to make sure that we are providing those services that keep people whole through a crisis, whether it's mental health services or education and childcare. Our families are really carrying a large part of this burden and of the economic downturn, the health crisis in general, and needing to make sure that everybody has access to quality health care is a top priority, that that we have access to PPE for workers that are essential and showing up every day to continue our economy as much as possible. And so really wanting to prioritize the services that are essential to keeping people housed, fed, and cared for as we go forward. So, but we will have a very difficult time. We have had to cut already in the special sessions this year. And so we're gonna, in the August special session, we're gonna need to continue fighting for, the most vulnerable among us will always be my priority and continue making sure that we're making fair decisions as we rebuild and look at really assessing our systems and making sure that we are rebuilding stronger where possible, because as devastating as this time is, there is also a potential that we have an opportunity to rebuild systems that work better for more Oregonians.
Okay, good. What are your thoughts on how legislators can avoid the acrimony and dysfunction of recent legislative sessions, which you're certainly very well aware of? What advice do you have for legislative leadership to ensure a more productive session?
Yeah, thanks. This is really a top priority for our legislature right now, to rebuild trust, to come together on behalf of Oregonians and do the work of the people. And I believe that we can disagree without being disagreeable. We can state our truth. We can be passionate about a stance, but we can also be collaborative. We can be civil. And those are the goals at the end of the day. So I always try to approach the legislation that I champion by feeling like where there's agreement, there's a path forward, and that's where we should begin. I like to make sure that the bills I lead on have bipartisan chief sponsors, and I've worked really hard to build relationships with other members of both parties in both my communities and in the legislature. And I'm really here to serve and acknowledge and listen and learn what all of the ideas are that are out there. And in the 2020 February session, before the walkout, there were only three bills that passed. And one of those bills was my bill to protect students who have experienced a concussion and to really give their teachers a tool to support them as they return to learn. But that was a bipartisan bill. It had bipartisan agreement, and it really sailed through as an example of what can happen when we work together on behalf of Oregonians.
Great. So the pandemic has certainly revealed the urgency of replacing antiquated government computer systems and also making internet access available to the 94,000 student Oregonians who lack any wired internet options. Can you comment on what legislation do this?
It cut out there at the end. Can you repeat the very last part of the question?
Yeah, how can legislation do this lack of internet service for so many Oregonians?
It kind of cut out again, but I got enough to realize it's ironic because the importance of the internet connection is essential right now. It's our lifeline. Am I smooth in our transfer of internet right now back to you? Or let me know, I guess, if it's cutting in and out. We have a lot to do to work on the broadband access that is helping so many Oregonians access their education, work, and making sure that we invest in the infrastructure needed to really address that. It's an equity issue. And so really wanting to make sure that we are investing in the infrastructure that's needed going forward.
What legislative committees have you served on, and what would you like to be serving on in the next session?
Oh, thanks. I have served on the Education Committee. I am the Vice Chair of the Education Committee going forward, and I am also a member of the Veterans and Emergency Preparedness Committee. Both committees have legislative hearings this week, so tomorrow morning will be the Education Committee, and Friday morning, I believe it's Friday morning, will be the Veterans and Emergency Preparedness Committee. So we'll be hearing updates from many of our departments on how things are going for them. I'm also a member of the Budget Committee for Natural Resources. And so we, assess lots of different spending things. So that's the kind of area that we have to make those hard decisions in that committee at the committee level of where can we cut when we already know that a lot of our agencies are trying really hard to do more with less. So let's see. And going forward was the next part of your question. I really enjoy my placements on these committees. I am very, very interested in mental health and would love to pay close attention to the Behavioral Health Committee. I find myself really drawn to the Health and Human Services Committee topics, as well as the Judiciary Committee topics. But so far, I've not asked for a change in placement. I'm so interested in learning about so many different topics. So that has been something that I've tried to learn more about without changing placements. But I will be leading a work group in the Education Committee because of my concern as a high school teacher, having seen the devastating impacts of anxiety and depression on our student population. I have asked for a work group to address the behavioral and mental health needs of our students in our education program from preschool through college. We have a lot to address. So we are at the front end of setting up a long-term work group. And my hope is that we'll also be able to apply some short-term solutions, some mental health supports for our students as they return to learn in isolation through distance learning, which can be quite stressful, and where they are wondering oftentimes how this is going to impact their future And that's for our middle school and high school population. And for the younger children in our elementary schools and preschools, how their parents are wondering how that's going to impact their children's growth and future and education. So we really have a lot of challenging times, and I want to just validate frustrations across the board. We know that everybody's doing their best, but the ratio of questions to answer is still that there are more questions than answers as we try to build our roadmaps and figure out a way through a pandemic and economic crisis, now our devastating wildfires, and just really trying to take it one step at a time and do our very best to keep everybody as whole as possible through this very trying time.
Courtney, thanks so much for talking to us today.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
And voters, don't forget to visit vote411.org for complete candidate and ballot measure information.